Good morning to you all. We're so happy to have you with us today as we come together in whatever means works for you and come to learn and to worship the Lord on this day that He has made. So we're going to open this morning with one of the most favorite hymns. It's actually number 7 on the favorites list, How Great Thou Art. This morning to proclaim how great Thou art. Father, we thank You for this day. We thank You for this privilege that we have to come together to worship Your name. The Father, we ask Your blessing on the service this morning, on the songs, on the words that will be spoken, and may they fall on receptive hearts. Father, we pray for Your children all over the world in this very difficult time. We pray that your strength and your mercies will be upon us all. And Father, we just pray for that day when all these difficulties will be behind us and your glory will fill the earth. So Father, until that day, keep us faithful, keep us for always looking upwards and just allowing your Spirit to work in us daily. So we ask for your Spirit to meet us here in a very special way this morning. And we ask all these things in the precious name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. So this morning, it's my privilege to introduce our brother Bruce Blake. And he's going to talk to us this morning. He's going to tell us about two resurrections. That's it, two resurrections and the Millennial Age. I'll turn it over to Brother Bruce.
Good morning. Good morning and welcome to you all once again. Resurrections of the dead in the Millennial Age. Last week, brethren, we, in our consideration of why Christians do not fear death, as part of our study on fear, we looked at Abraham's reasoning of what God would need to do in order to keep his covenant with Isaac. Were Abraham to sacrifice Isaac on the mountain of in Moriah, as commanded by God, the gist of the reasoning was that since it was impossible for God to not fulfill his covenant with Isaac, that many peoples and nations would come through him, and since Isaac had yet to have any children, that if Abraham sacrificed him, then God could and would do something, even if it meant raising Isaac from the dead to fulfill his covenant. We then applied the same reasoning to God's promise and covenant with Abraham, that through thee and thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Since God's covenant with Abraham has still yet to be fulfilled, and there have been tens of billions of people who have already died, then the same reasoning would be this: God would need to do something in order to raise those tens of billions who have died, even if he had to raise them from the dead in order for God to fulfill that covenant. God would do that, there being no question that God must fulfill his covenant. The question is when. Then we ended the session with John 5, 28, 29a, where Jesus says, "Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming, in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth." The promised resurrection of all the dead is the reason Christians should not fear death. Apostle Paul explains where he and all we Christians are, if in fact there is no resurrection of the dead. 1 Corinthians 15, 12 to 19, we're looking at. Paul says, "Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead?" You'll notice, brethren, we are not the first to notice that the dead never return. We're not the first to ask, how does this happen? Paul continues, "But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised us He raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. Now, brethren, for you poker players, this is known as being all in. Paul has pushed all his chips into the middle of the table, all his credibility. He has withheld not one chip, for if Christ is not physically, literally risen from the dead, and nobody questions whether Christ was dead and buried, then we are all like those who have no hope. Paul is a liar, a false witness. For Paul reiterates with no equivocation what he is stating here, brethren, is God raised Jesus from the dead, period. If that is not true, then you can and must reject everything that the great apostle Paul has told us about Jesus Christ. Paul's claim is that no man gave him the gospel message, but that he received it in revelation directly from Jesus Christ. Galatians 1:11 and 12.